all sorts of fun things planned. We got pumpkins out, we got Christmas out, and we're just getting ready for everything.
We need a turkey.
That's right. Just great, great stuff. And so thank you for joining us tonight. We want to open with a word of prayer, and we're going to have some great time in worshiping the Lord together. Let's pray, shall we? Father, thank you for the privilege that we have to come to this place and to lift up your holy name. For Lord, you are awesome, you are amazing, you are wonderful, and it is a joy to give you praise. We pray, Lord, today that you would, as your word says, inhabit the praises of your people. So thank you for hanging out with us as we lift up your holy name. May we not hold back and giving you the glory that's due your name.
Amen.
We bless you, we thank you, and we worship you.
Yes.
In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone said,
Amen.
Let's worship the Lord, shall we?
Well, this is the day that the Lord has made.
For this is the day he has made. Amen.
Sacrifices of praises, Lord. Lord Jesus, when we don't feel like it, Lord, we sacrifice our own flesh and we offer you praise, Lord. We offer you thanksgiving and we offer joy unto the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah, Lord.
Show is power.
we give you praise, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah to the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. And I sing praises to your name.
Spirit, may take a moment and just allow the Holy Spirit to rain down on us and invite Him in. Hallelujah, Lord, hallelujah. Spirit of God, rain down on this place. Do your amazing work as only you can do it. We bless your name. Spirit of God, touch lives, anoint our hearts, draw us close to you. Give us a fresh touch from heaven. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Father, where would we be without you? Jesus, where would we be without you? Spirit of God, where would we be without you? Thank you, Lord, for what you are doing. Thank you, Lord, for touching us in the past. But Lord, I pray that you give us a fresh anointing for today. A fresh touch of your Spirit here in this place right now tonight. May we sense your presence. May we walk in your presence. May your joy fill our hearts in a fresh way, Lord, today. We bless your name. We bless your name. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for moving amongst us in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 God is so good to us. All the time, He is.
Good.
Great to have you here tonight. Great to have you here. Thank you, Ken. Thank you, Christy. Thank you, thank you, thank you, Al, for leading us. What a great thing it is to lead. Good. We want to take a moment. We want to pray together. And we have that list that's there on your lavender color sheet. It's there each and every night. So we encourage you to pick that up. Who also, though, would raise their hand tonight and say, you know, Pastor, would you pray for me? I've got a need either in my own life or in someone who's near and dear to me where you would ask God to bring about a miracle, a breakthrough. Go ahead and raise your hand high. And as we pray, just keep your hand up. And in a sense, you're saying, God, see me today. See my need today. Okay, let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we take this moment tonight and we lift up every hand, every person who has said, Lord, I need a breakthrough. I need your help. I need a miracle. Thank you, Lord, that you're Jehovah Jireh. You're a provider. Thank you that you are Jehovah Rophe, that you are our healer. And we pray, Lord, that you bring miracles, you bring healing, you bring restoration. Lord, that you would bring provision. Lord, that you would bring reconciliation into relationships. Lord, whatever it may be, thank you for doing your amazing work. We add to that wonderful people that are on this list. We ask that you would touch them from the top of their head to the soles of their feet, that the healing virtue of Jesus would be all over them. Thank you for bringing breakthrough into lives as only you can. We give it to you tonight, and we bless your holy name in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Thank you so very much. We want to receive an offering tonight, and I want to thank you for your faithful giving to not only to Living Proof, but even more so, your faithful giving of your tithes and offerings. Friends, what we do here at the church is overwhelmingly sustained by your tithes and offerings, what you're giving as unto the Lord. A tithe is a tenth of what we've earned, and we give that back to Jesus cheerfully because he's calling us to be a cheerful giver. And so let's pray over this offering as we receive it tonight. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to worship you in song and in prayer. And Lord, tonight we pause at this moment and we say, we want to worship you in giving. And so, Lord, I pray that you bless the gift that's given, that you bless even more so the giver who gives it. Thank you, Lord, for the heart of generosity in which they give tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Thank you so much for that. As you're giving, we want to also let you know that next Wednesday night, we're going to have a special communion service. And so we encourage you to come, be a part of it. Maybe you know someone else that would come with you that's not able to get out on Sundays, and an opportunity for us to have communion here in this place. And so what a good thing it is to celebrate the Lord's table together. Thank you for that. At this time, I'd like to ask John L. Martin if he would come forward. How many of you are thankful for John? Yes, indeed. Great man of God, and he has got a great teaching tonight. I was inspired. I walked away going, man, that was good stuff. And so thank you, John, for bringing this teaching forward. I hope, I trust that all of you have that white sheet that's stapled, because actually it's not just a sheet, it's a packet for tonight's teaching. Thank you, brother. Bless you.
Thank you, Pastor.
Thank you, God.
I have an additional treat that I wasn't expecting. Her brought some pictures of the Holy Land and his trip, and we're going to pass those around. Among them is an olive tree from the Gethsemane that is over 2,000 years old, and some point out it could be the one that Jesus prayed next to. Also, there is a couple of pictures, and one that's up close of the Calvary that is presumed with the skull on it, and also of the tomb where Jesus was hastily buried, and also of the Wailing Wall. Some great pictures. We're going to pass these around with some wonderful descriptions that his wife put together on those. It was from a few years ago, and I want you to enjoy those, because we are talking tonight about the burial of our Lord and the resurrection of our Lord tonight, as we look at the Feast of Unleavened Bread and the Feast of First Fruits. So enjoy these as they are passed around, please. Sorry, Ken. Hope I didn't mess something up. Please turn in your notes to the first page that has the little chart on it, and we'll begin our study into the Feast of Unleavened Bread and the Feast of First Fruits. This is lesson 3 in our series, taken from scripture from Leviticus chapter 23, beginning with verse 4. These are the feasts, introducing all 7 feasts, which is the word in the Hebrew, moed, which means appointment. These are the appointments of the Lord. He pulled out his appointment calendar and he called you up, and he says, your appointment is tomorrow, just like my doctor did. And I got to show up. And the Lord has said, these are your appointments every year. They are holy convocations, and the Hebrew word is mikra, which means rehearsals. Each one is a rehearsal with a purpose. It has a plan and an outline for a prophetic event. And for some of us now, we look back and they are historic events. These feasts will be observed during the 1,000-year millennial reign of Christ, when they will see all of these feasts were shadows of him. And as they come to Jerusalem to worship, then all of these things will finally make sense. Verse 6, and on the 15th day of the same month as Passover, the first month of the religious calendar of the Jews in the spring, is the Feast of Unleavened Bread. 7 days you must eat unleavened bread. On the first day you shall have a holy convocation. You shall do no customary work on it, but you shall offer an offering made by fire to the Lord for 7 days. The 7th day shall be a holy convocation. You shall do no customary work. We're accustomed to understanding that the Jewish people on the Sabbath day, Saturday, did not work. In this case, we have on the first day of the unleavened bread is like a Sabbath day. They did no work. The 7th day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, they did no work. And for 7 days, this is your bread. Here you go. Put that together for a tuna sandwich. You know, I mentioned it this afternoon, is I've seen saltine crackers look more appealing than these things. It's got holes in it, and it looks like it's been burnt. You know, and the idea is stripes. Stripes and pierced. The unleavened bread. Pierced like our Lord, and with stripes on his back. This for 7 days. during that period of time, we have more days. The weekly Sabbath takes place during those 7 days. So there is another day when there is no work done, another day of holiness. And then on the Sunday within those 7 days is the Feast of First Fruits. We'll talk about that in a moment. The Feast of First Fruits, when you come in with your grain offering. That is all taking place in 7 days. And add to that Passover, the day before the unleavened bread, you have these holy days, the Passover, the first day of the unleavened bread, the Saturday, the Sunday, and then the last day of unleavened bread. 5 holy days, all within a short span of time. God calls the first day a holy convocation, the day immediately following Passover. This is the day the Israelites celebrate as the day that they were set free from 400 years of Egyptian bondage, which is found in Numbers 33:3. This is the day that they started leaving Egypt. Now remember the Passover meal, if you remember the Seder and looking at it, it was a huge meal. And they were told to eat everything. Don't leave nothing behind. It's kind of like Thanksgiving. When you see a little bit of gravy in the plate, you get out your biscuits and you sop it up. You know, you get it every bit, every crumb, and you eat it all. And by this time, every dad in the place is sleepy. You know what happens on Thanksgiving? They all sit back and want to take a nap. There is a huge meal. And the next day, the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the first day, they're leaving Egypt. Now notice something, that it takes faith to do something like this. They are still slaves on Passover. They're still in bondage on Passover. They're eating this huge meal, and Moses has instructed them to put on their hiking boots, pack their backpacks full of stuff, get their suitcases going, get the Samsonite luggage all piled up on the rack, get your donkey harnessed up to your wagon, have your staff in your hand as you eat your meal. Why? Because you're leaving in the morning. Now that takes a lot of faith to believe something like that after you've been in a slave for 400 years. The only thing they had for sure was the word that Moses gave to them, that God said, you're going to be set free. Now friends, the rapture could happen any minute. And may I ask you, are you packed up, dressed up, prayed up, and ready to go?
Amen.
Amen. We are about to escape the world of tears and sweat and sin. Let's be ready.
Let's go.
God calls the seventh day a holy convocation day. This is the day that is customarily believed that the seventh day is when they passed over the Red Sea. This is the day that the Egyptian army that was chasing them to kill them was destroyed in the Red Sea. This is the day that God promised, you will see your enemies no more forever. God destroyed the destroyers. The people are set free, no more having to look over their shoulder to see if anybody was following them to attack them. They're going to the promised land. God is going to give them houses they didn't build, vineyards they didn't plant, and wells they didn't dig. They went in Egypt as poor shepherds. They leave with all the riches of Egypt in their wagons. The book of Psalms, chapter 103, says, there was not a feeble one in their midst. That's the one thing that was wrong with the movie of the Ten Commandments, having people with crutches and hobbling along. No. Every single one of them was healed completely. And the first statement that God gives them after they pass through the Red Sea, I am the Lord that healeth thee. This was his promise. This was his direction. This was his claim. I'm the one that healed you.
Amen.
Friends, we are going to a land where we will never die.
Thank you.
No more tears, no more heartaches, no more aching bodies, no more sicknesses and diseases, no more doctor's appointments. We're all going, no more masks. We're all going to the land where the Lamb is the light. We are going to see our Savior and our loved ones who have gone before us. There will be there to be together forever. What a glorious homecoming is ours. When the Apostle John was talking about the crucifixion of our Lord, he says in chapter 19 that the Passover day was a preparation day for the next day. The next day was the first day of unleavened bread. Listen to what he says. Because it was the preparation day that the bodies should not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for that Sabbath was a high Sabbath. First, the Passover was preparation for the following day, the high day, the holy convocation day, the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread. Number two, Jesus had passed away, had died by 3 p.m. The other two men, the two thieves, still hanging on the cross, could have lived for another 2 or 3 days. This was customary. Those men being crucified, still hanging on the crosses, would defile the feast day of the first day of unleavened bread for the entire nation. They must be taken down, or the religious pollution could not be averted. The law, the Torah said, Deuteronomy 21, reading from the English version, and if a man has committed a crime punishable by death, and he is put to death, and you hang him on a tree, his body shall not remain all night on the tree, but you shall bury the same day, for a hanged man is cursed by God. You shall not defile your land that the Lord your God is giving you for an inheritance. This was critical. This was imperative. Those three had to be taken down quickly. This is the fulfillment of the Feast of Unleavened Bread. Bread that does not have yeast in it. You don't wait for it to rise. You whack it together and you stick it in the oven and you cook it. You get it done quickly. Jesus fulfilled this, being buried in haste. Jesus being buried in haste on the day of Passover so that his dead body would not defile the day of holy convocation. Now, don't you find it interesting that the Pharisees had no problem with killing Jesus on Passover day, but they didn't want his body on the cross on the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread? That was the day they celebrated getting out of Egypt. The miracle of the angels passing over was not as important to them as getting out of Egypt. So you follow this? Getting out of jail was more important than the miracle that gave them the why of getting out of jail. It doesn't that tell you something about their twisted thinking and their traditions? The death of a person being crucified could take several days. Jesus been on the cross only 6 hours when he died. Pilate was surprised when Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus asked for permission to bury the body of Jesus in Luke 24:50. Pilate asked the Roman centurion that had been in charge of the crucifixion if Jesus was so soon dead. In Mark 15, when he heard it of the centurion, he gave them permission to bury Jesus. Why did Jesus die in only 6 hours? Because he needed to. He needed to fulfill the Feast of Unleavened Bread. Don't ever forget, Jesus was in control of his crucifixion. He was in control of when he would die. And he picked the exact time, 3 p.m, when the Lamb is slain in the temple for the people for their sins. When that Lamb was slain, Jesus passed away. And that's when the earthquake hit, and that's when the temple curtain was ripped from top to bottom. Yeah. At that same moment, he was in complete, total control of everything. What is unleavened bread all about? Well, the Israelites were leaving behind the sins and the contaminating influences of Egypt. In the Bible, leaven is a symbol of sin and evil. These days of unleavened bread symbolize our effort to eliminate from our life the culture and the influences of this world and the temptations of Satan in our lives. Before the Jews can celebrate the feast, every scrap of leaven in the house must be removed as they eat the unleavened bread for 7 days. We enjoy watching a fellow named Dennis Prager. See how many smiles I have in the place. Okay. Dennis Prager is a Jewish man who stands up for America and for Christians. And he has a wonderful YouTube video of what it means to have a Passover meal in the Seder. And he talks about how in every Jewish family, the dad leads all the children trying to find the last scrap of leaven that's in the house to get it out of the house before they do the celebration. And every one of them says, and mom always leaves a piece of leaven right where dad can find it so that he can say, aha, I got the last piece of leaven in the house. Now you know who's in charge of the home, don't you? The 7 days of unleavened bread symbolize a holy walk before the Lord, a life without sin. Paul summarized the meaning of this feast for Christians. Purge out, therefore, the old leaven, that ye may be a new lump, as ye are unleavened, you are without leaven. For even Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast, not with old leaven, neither with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. Paul was calling Christians to a consistent walk of holiness. Don't walk as carnal men walk. The Apostle John said in 1 John 2:6, he who says he abides in him ought to himself also walk just as he walked. Most Christian churches don't talk much about holiness like we did 40, 50 years ago. The motto then of holiness movement was, don't just talk the walk, but walk the talk. The holiness movement arose with a calling to live a sanctified life with the goal of Christian perfection and a completed Christian character in our daily lives. Jumping down to Jesus and the bread, Jesus was born in Bethlehem, which means the house of bread. He used bread as an image of himself. He said, if a kernel of wheat falls to the ground, it must die and brings forth life. Jesus is the bread of life. As God gave manna to the Israelites, he also gave his son the bread of life, that whoever believes in him may have everlasting life. And he says, I will raise him up at the last day, John 6:32. Bread represents the word of God, untainted by the world and the traditions of men. Jesus is that word, untainted, unspoiled, the pure word of God. In the Lord's Prayer, John 17, he says, Father, sanctify them by thy truth. Thy word is truth. The Passover matzah, if you've seen this before, this matzah, you notice that it is striped. Those stripes represent the stripes on our Savior's back. By his stripes, we were healed. He was pierced, that they shall look upon him whom they have pierced. Jesus, the sinless bread, striped for our healing. His stripes bring us healing now. His piercing of his body brings us salvation now. During the Passover, there is a stack of three of these matzah breads, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The middle one is always taken out and broken in half, and half of that is taken and put behind the back of the dad while they have the other one that is out in front. And that one they break and eat. And Jesus said, this is my body broken for you. What was the piece behind the back? He's coming again. He's coming again. Amen. He's hidden now, but he won't be hidden for long. Amen. He's coming again. Hallelujah. Jesus was buried before the beginning of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, which took place at 6 p.m. on Passover afternoon, the 14th. He is the kernel of wheat placed in the ground to rise again, the first of many brethren. Romans 8:29, for God knew his people in advance, he chose them to become like his son, so that his son could be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. Beloved, no one permanently buries a Christian. Christians do not die. Christians move from this life to the next life.
Amen.
I love what Barbara Davidson says. You can't scare me with heaven. I'm ready to go. First fruits. The third feast is held on Sunday following Passover. Speak unto the children of Israel, it says in Leviticus 23, and say unto them, When ye become into the land which I have given unto you, you shall reap the harvest thereof, then ye shall bring a sheaf of first fruits of your harvest unto the priest, and he shall wave the sheaf before the Lord to be accepted for you on the morrow after the Sabbath, the priest shall wave it. That's Sunday. We bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. We bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. And we offer up to you the sacrifice of thanksgiving. And we offer up to you the sacrifice of praise.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
That's what this is all about.
Amen.
The feast of first fruits to praise and honor our Lord. God wanted a special feast during this is for the Israelites, and knowing that the fertility of the land that he had given them was from him. They were to bring the early crops of the spring planting, the first fruits, to the priest at the temple to be waved before the Lord on their behalf. This was done on the morrow after the Sabbath, Sunday, the first day of the week. Since the Feast of Unleavened Bread was 7 days long, one of those 7 days is a Sunday. The Sunday that they celebrated first fruits, which we today call Easter. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15:23, every man in his own order, Christ, the first fruits. The word order in Greek is the word tagma, which means first in a procession. It's like a grand marshal in the parade. He is always first. We miss a very important biblical truth by not using this term, first fruits, when we come to Easter, because first implies there is a second, and a third, and a fourth, and so on. And that is the real meaning of this feast. Yes, we celebrate the resurrection of the Lord with first fruits on Sunday, but we also, with first fruits prophetically, are looking at the rapture. The rapture of the church, all will be resurrected and go to heaven, and there they shall be forever with the Lord.
Amen.
Every man in his own order.
Amen.
Praise God.
Praise God.
Paul presented this brilliantly. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. But every man in his own order, Christ, the firstfruits, and afterward they that are Christ's at his coming. We'll jump down to Christians and the law of first fruits. If you obey God's clear guidelines concerning the first fruits, in giving you will prosper exceedingly abundantly above all you can ask or think. God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. If you really believe that, then listen to what I'm trying to share with you tonight. When the Israelites did not practice these rules of first fruits, God said to them in the book of Malachi chapter 3, you are thieves. You are stealing from me. Listen, God is saying the same thing to you and to me. If you can quote and claim and proclaim and repeat the prosperity scriptures all day long, it won't do you any good, because God will not listen to you if you are not obeying him in first fruits. If you're not following this process, you are a thief. God called the Israelites thieves, and he has every right to call us thieves. The law of first of the spirit world is just as operational as the laws of the natural world. God's law of gravity keeps you and me from flying off into space. Without gravity, you and I can't walk. I wish gravity would give me a break every morning when I get on the scales. But there it is, in all of its ugliness. Oh my. The law of first fruits is God's law. For you, for me. This is something God has been backing up since the days of Moses 3,500 years ago. I'm not talking about something you have to hope will happen in the by and by. I'm talking about rules that if you follow them, they will happen for you and you're right here and you're right now. This is not in your notes, so listen up. Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 18. It is the Lord who gives you the power to get wealth. Paul DeJong said, God does not get wealth for you. He empowers you to get wealth. J.D. Rockefeller, I believe the power to make money is a gift from Almighty God. I believe the money that I make is to be used for the good of my fellow man. And we're talking about money, and it usually gets real quiet. I get folks say, hey, I got your attention. Adrian Rogers said one time, the most sensitive nerve in the human body is that one that runs from your heart to your wallet. And when I touch your wallet, it gets your attention. When Jesus gave his parables, 16 of the 38 involve money. There are 500 verses about prayer. How many are there about money? 2,000. The famous story that Jesus gave about the pearl of great price. He said that there was this rich man that came into a foreign land and he saw a treasure in this field. And he went back home and he took all of his possessions together and he sold them to come back and to get that field so that he could get the treasure in the field. It cost him everything to get that treasure. I've grown up in church and I've heard so many people say, Jesus is the pearl of great price. No, no. Jesus was the price to buy the field. You are the pearl of great price for which he gave his life, for which God bankrupted heaven to get you, to get me. You're the pearl of great price. Amen. Praise God. He cares about us that much.
Amen.
Top of page 4 of your notes, God wanted a special feast during these... Oops, I'm on the wrong page. I got to turn. I've already done that one before.
Yep. And 5.
Pay attention to that, Ken, when you look at the video, then you don't get that. Okay. If you follow these laws of first fruits, second paragraph from the bottom of page 4, God is going to bless your income. He's going to curse the devourer for your sake. Bottom of page 4. He's going to make Satan pay you back for all he's stolen from you. That's in his word. How many of you think that you'd like to have a piece of that happening in your life? Then listen and follow. I have a word from the Lord for you. Put God first.
Amen.
Put God first in everything.
Amen.
Jesus told the people in the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 6:33, seek first the kingdom of God. That means seek God's rule, his authority in your life, in your home, and in your family. And seek his righteousness. That means pursue first his purity, purity in mind and body and spirit. Paul admonishes us to have the mind of Christ. To do this, then God has promised that he will add to us all things. Now, what are the all things? I like things. If you go back to Matthew 6, you'll find out what things he was talking about. Just in a few short verses before verse 33, he talks about your health. He talks about your stature. He talks about your food. He talks about your home. He talks about, I have come to give you life and give you life more abundantly. All of these things in the here and now of life. all these things he will give to us if we seek his kingdom first and his righteousness. Listen, God did not say, live a perfect, faultless life, and then you'll get all these things. No, he said, put me first, and you'll get all these things. David said, early in the morning, I will seek you. God is looking for someone who's looking for him.
Thank you.
3 John 1:2, beloved, I wish above all things that you prosper and be in health, just as your soul prospers. Here's the law of the first fruits. Anything you give God first sanctifies everything that follows. Whatever you sanctify first continues to sanctify all the things that come after it. Why do we worship on Sunday? It's the day Jesus rose from the dead. It's the day that Paul told us, bring your tithes and offerings into the storehouse on the first day of the week. But it is also the first day of the week. It is the day of first fruits. C.S. Lewis said, when first things are put first, second things always prosper. That's profound. Whatever you do, what God wants you to do first, everything that follows it is supernaturally blessed by the Father. When you worship God on Sunday, you are sanctifying Wednesday. You are sanctifying Thursday. Because you have put God first, his blessing rests on everything that follows. When you get a raise, you give the first raise increment to him. Now you said, but that's my money. Sure it is. But you didn't have it last month. You can do without it this month. Put him first. Give him the first of it. And he will bless all the rest that follows. God said in Malachi, I am the Lord. I do not change. There are no other gods before me. Putting God first in your life establishes him as the Lord over your life. If he is not first, he is not Lord. If he is not Lord, there's no favor, there's no promises, there's no blessings, there's no prosperity. Your life is lived under a curse, as what happened to Adam, with weeds and thorns and drought. Those who obey will be blessed. Jumping down. God preached the very first prosperity sermon. If you will honor him with your first fruits, he will prosper all you do and all you have. Moses said in Leviticus 23:10, when you arrive at the land that I am giving you and reap its harvest, bring the first grains of the harvest to the priest on the first day of the week. Don't eat any bread until you have presented this offering to your Lord. Why? Because you are saying he is first. God says in Isaiah 45, I am the Lord, there is no other. In Matthew 9, I am the Lord of the harvest. In 1 Corinthians 3, we are God's co-workers in the field. Genesis 1, God has given us every seed-bearing plant and tree on earth. Genesis 8, he has caused the seed, time, and harvest to never end. Leviticus 26, God sends us the rains in the season, so that the land will yield its produce and the trees bear fruit and the vines bear their grapes. In Jeremiah 29, I know the plans I have for you, plans to prosper you, plans of a hope and a blessed future. 1 Peter 2, we are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. We are God's special possession. Revelation 4, you are worthy, O Lord, of all praise and honor, for you have created all things, and for your pleasure they are and were created. He is the Lamb of God who has redeemed us by his blood and made us kings and priests unto our God, and we shall reign with him on the earth. God says 6 times in the Old Testament, you shall not appear to me, before me, empty-handed. God can't bless something you don't give. If you don't give, you tie God's hands of blessings. Jesus said in Luke 6, give and it shall be given to you. If you give nothing, you get nothing. The Israelites were complaining about God not blessing them, and he says in Malachi 3, are you surprised? You've been robbing me. They asked how. He said, all these years you've robbed me in tithes and offerings. Come now, put me to the test. Bring the tithes and offerings to my house, and I'll open up the windows of heaven and pour out blessings you can't contain. Amen. Friends, you want God's blessing? The initiative rests with us. Amen. If you've not been doing it in the past, just ask him to forgive you and say, I'm going to start doing it now. He will bless you now. He wants to bless you now. We tie his hands of blessing by not giving. Now, he promised to give back 30, 40, 60, 100-fold. Have you ever figured out what 100-fold is on your money? What's the percentage? I had to have somebody tell me. It's 10,000%.
Wow.
Oh, my word. He's promised to give us 10,000%. Land, the Goshens. That's something else. I was looking at this. This wasn't in the afternoon, but I'll tell you guys. I was looking at this thing when David was talking about building the temple for the Lord. He gave of his own personal wealth. Okay? 122 tons of gold.
Wow. Wow.
265 tons of silver. The value of that money today is $557 million of his own personal money.
Wow.
Not too bad for a shepherd, eh? Huh? He learned the truth of first fruits, and God outgave him. God will outgive you if you will give to him. God can't answer prayers you don't pray. God can't bless and multiply what you don't give. Isaiah 45:11, this is the most astounding statement I've ever read in Scripture. God says to you and me, command ye me. Command ye me in your faithfulness to him and obeying his commands and his directions for how we should live. We have the opportunity, according to the book of Hebrews, to come in boldly before the throne of Christ and let him have our needs. Let him hear our prayers, and he will answer. If Jesus is not Lord of all, he's not Lord at all. In the story of Jericho, when they first came into the land, it was the first city that they conquered, and Achan took some of the treasures out of the city of Jericho and hid them in his tent. And when they failed at the next battle, Joshua asked God, what's the matter? And he said, there's sin in the camp. They went and found out that Achan had stolen some of the stuff. And they took it. They put it back in the land of Jericho and burned it. And everything that was in Jericho belonged to God. And from that point on, every other city they conquered, the treasures belonged to them. But the first city, Jericho, belonged to God. Jesus, the Son of God, the Lamb of God, was God's sacrifice for man. On Sunday after Passover, he fulfilled the first fruits. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15, Jesus is the first of a great harvest of all who have died. The message says, he is the first in a long legacy of those who are going to leave the cemeteries. I can't wait to see that happen. Hallelujah. The first fruit sanctifies what follows. What follows is Jesus. What follows Jesus? His saints, his believers. John 14, because I live, you shall live also. His resurrection guarantees your resurrection, guarantees my resurrection. Paul said in 1 Corinthians, behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye at the last trump. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. The feast of first fruits is two things. First, it's Jesus, the first of many risen from the dead. And second, it's you and me who make God first in our lives. We partake in the Lord's first fruits as his harvest. Go to God today and start over fresh. Make him first in all things in your life. He'll let you do that. He wants to hear from you. He wants you to untie his hands so that he can open up the windows of heaven and abundantly above all that you ask or think, bless you. He'll do that. It's his promise to every one of us. I would like to offer you this prayer in conclusion. Lord Jesus, be Lord of all. All my life, all my possessions, all my abilities, be my Lord. It's in you we have the riches of heaven promised to us. It's in you we have an inheritance of eternal life. To you be the glory. Great things you have done. We give you thanks. We give you praise. For you are worthy of it all. Amen and amen. He is worthy of it all. Hallelujah. God bless you. Pastor, if you would come, look forward to having an opportunity to hear some more of what you said this afternoon.
What John taught on this afternoon and tonight is powerful, friends.
Amen.
You know, I think about that piece of bread, that he was pierced for us, as by his stripes that we are healed. And when we see that in a piece of matzah that we can buy in the store today, it's powerful stuff. It's powerful stuff. John talked about first fruits. This afternoon, I was so convicted. I was sat there thinking, you know what? I hadn't paid my tithe yet. I got my phone out while he was teaching. I paid my tithe on push pay. And we're like, okay, I got to make sure I can give my first fruits, right? God's not looking for your leftovers.
Amen.
He's looking for your first and your best.
Amen.
He deserves our best. So let's give that to him. Amen to that?
Amen.
Amen. You know, I love this this decoration of wheat. And during this season of the year, it's kind of a popular thing to be able to go to a store and see this. Since I spent 4.5 years in wheat territory of Eastern Washington as a pastor, I learned a lot about wheat. This is soft white wheat. You may not know that. This is what's known as soft white wheat. The reason I know that is because the wheat kind of looks feathery at the top. It's the version of what that is. And soft white wheat is different than hard red or hard white. And the state of Washington grows almost exclusively soft white wheat. Hard red would be what you see in a wheat bread that's kind of cracked wheats. It's a harder, darker wheat bread. You've got the hard white that you can go get that wheat bread from the store. Same thing, we got bread over here tonight. And soft white is what you get most of your pasta made out of. Gets crushed down and ground a certain way that gets rolled out. Some of it from the state of Washington gets sent to the Pacific Rim, and some of it stays here in the United States. Some of it's exported, and some of it stays here. And the only reason I know that is when you're a pastor in a wheat territory, you learn everything about wheat that you can possibly imagine. And it's really cool because it's at this time of the year that this wheat that kind of grows about 3 feet tall, and you have a gentle breeze, and it just goes for miles and miles, and it's an amazing thing. It's amazing what God does in a plant like this, where one kernel of wheat that gets crushed and thrown into the ground, and all of a sudden, an amazing plant grows out of that, and the germination process starts all over again. I want you to be reminded that God cares about each one of you. And sometimes we feel like we're beaten and bruised and crushed. But God wants to plant something new inside of your heart and do a fresh work within your life. Thank you, John, for your teaching tonight. What a great thing. Yeah, give him a hand. Let's pray, shall we? Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you. We thank you, Lord, for sealing this in our hearts. And may we be people who are eager to be used of you, eager to say, Lord, here's my first fruit. Here's what I have to offer. Lord, sometimes we don't feel like it's much. But in the midst of whatever it is that we give, as we give up our first fruit back to you, we give up that tithe back to you. Lord, you're the one who's the multiplier. You're the one who's the one who brings it back 100-fold. So Lord, thank you for doing your special work within our lives. We give this to you tonight in Jesus' name. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen.
There are three easy ways to give tonight. The first is through PushPay. Simply text through your smartphone VF Assembly to 77977. The second is by going to the church website at www.vfassembly.org and click Give at the top right side of your screen. The third way you can give is to mail your giving directly to the church at 15260 Nisqually Road in Victorville, 92395. Thank you, and may God bring His richest blessings upon you as you give. God bless.